Washington Post columnist and commentator George Will says that Ulysses Grant's memoirs, written as the general was dying in 1885, is the greatest military memoir in the English language. Missouri-born Samuel Clemens published Grant's memoirs in 1886. The English poet Matthew Arnold lodged mild criticism of the grammar of Grant's work. Here's what Mark Twain said. "We only remember that this is the simple soldier who, untaught of the silken phrase makers, linked words together with an art surpassing the art of the schools and put into them a something which will still bring to American ears, as long as America shall last, the roll of his vanished drums and the tread of the marching hosts." Second year, Ulysses Grant became ill. Before he struggled to survive, this is what he recorded in his memoir.
"From Harrisburg to Philadelphia, there was a railroad, the first I had ever seen, except the one on which I had just crossed the summit of the Allegheny Mountains, and over which canal boats were transported. In traveling by the road from Harrisburg, I thought the perfection of rapid transit had been reached. We traveled at least 18 miles an hour when at full speed and made the whole distance averaging probably as much as 12 miles an hour. This seemed like annihilating space. I stopped 5 days in Philadelphia and saw about every street in the city, attended the theater, visited Girard College, which was then in course of construction, and got reprimanded from home afterwards for dallying by the way so long. My sojourn in New York was shorter, but long enough to enable me to see the city very well. I reported at West Point on the 30th or 31st of May, and about 2 weeks later passed my examination for admission without difficulty, very much to my surprise. A military life had no charms for me, and I had not the faintest idea of staying in the Army, even if I should be graduated, which I did not expect. We had no transportation, and the country about Salt River was sparsely settled, so that it took some days to collect teams and drivers enough to move the camp and garrison equipage of a regiment nearly 1,000 strong, together with a week's supply of provision and some ammunition. We halted at night on the road and proceeded the next morning at an early hour. Harris had been encamped in a creek bottom for the sake of being near water. The hills on either side of the creek extend to a considerable height, possibly more than 100 feet. As we approached the brow of the hill from which it was expected we could see Harris' camp and possibly find his men ready formed to meet us, my heart kept getting higher and higher until it felt to me as though it was in my throat. I would have given anything to have been back in Illinois, but I had not the moral courage to halt and consider what to do. I kept right on. When we reached a point from which the valley below was in full view, I halted. The place where Harris had been encamped a few days before was still there, and the marks of a recent encampment were plainly visible. But the troops were gone. My heart resumed its place. It occurred to me at once that Harris had been as much afraid of me as I had been of him. This was a view of the question I had never taken before, but it was one I never forgot afterwards. From that event to the close of the war, I never experienced trepidation upon confronting an enemy, though I have always felt more or less anxiety. I never forgot that he had as much reason to fear my forces as I had his. The lesson was valuable. In a short time after our return to Salt River Bridge, I was ordered with a regiment to the town of Mexico. General Pope was then commanding the district, embracing all of the state of Missouri between the Mississippi and Missouri rivers, with his headquarters in the village of Mexico.
In his memoir, the general wrote,
"I had been in Jefferson City but a few days when I was directed from department headquarters to fit out an expedition to Lexington, Boonville, and Chillicothe in order to take from the banks in those cities all the funds they had and send them to St. Louis. The Western Army had not yet been supplied with transportation. It became necessary, therefore, to press into service teams belonging to sympathizers with the rebellion or to hire those of Union men. In 7 or 8 days from my assuming command in Jefferson City, I had all the troops, except a small garrison, at an advanced position and expected to join them myself the next day. But my campaigns had not yet begun. For a while seated at my office door with nothing further to do until it was time to start from the front, I saw an officer of rank approaching who proved to be Colonel Jefferson C. Davis. I had never met him before, but he introduced himself by handing me an order for him to proceed to Jefferson City and relieve me of command. The orders directed that I should report at department headquarters at St. Louis without delay to receive important instructions was about an hour before the only regular train of the day would start. Therefore, I turned over to Colonel Davis my orders and hurriedly stated to him the progress that had been made to carry out the department instructions already described. I had at that time but one staff officer, doing myself all the detail work usually performed by an adjutant general. In an hour after being relieved from the command, I was on my way to St. Louis, leaving my single staff officer to follow the next day with our horse and baggage. The important special instructions which I received the next day assigned me to the command of the District of Southeast Missouri, embracing all the territory south of St. Louis in Missouri, as well as southern Illinois.
the former president received a devastating diagnosis in October 1884, but still, the president wrote on.
Before daylight, General Smith brought to me the following letter from General Buckner. Headquarters, Fort Donelson, February 16, 1862. Sir, in consideration of all the circumstances governing the present situation of affairs in this station, I propose to the commanding officer of the Federal forces the appointment of commissioners to agree upon the terms of capitulation of the forces and fort under my command, and in that view suggest an armistice until 12 o'clock today. I am, sir, very respectfully, your obedient service, S.B. Buckner, Brigadier General C.S.A. To this I responded as follows. Headquarters, Army in the Field, Camp near Donelson, February 16, 1862. General S.B. Buckner, Confederate Army. Sir, yours of this date proposing armistice and appointment of commissioners to settle terms of capitulation is just received. No terms except an unconditional and immediate surrender can be accepted. I propose to move immediately upon your works. I am, sir, very respectfully, your obedient servant, U.S. Grant, Brigadier General.
General and President had this to say.
All secret oath-bound political parties are dangerous to any nation, no matter how pure or how patriotic the motives and principles which first bring them together. No political party can or ought to exist when one of its cornerstones is opposition to freedom of thought and to the right to worship God, according to the dictate of one's own conscience, or according to the creed of any religious denomination whatever. Nevertheless, if a sect sets up its laws as binding above the state laws, wherever the two come in conflict, this claim must be resisted and suppressed at whatever cost.
Spring of 1885, the great commander nearly choked to death, but he wrote on.
On the last of January 1865, peace commissioners from the so-called Confederate states presented themselves on our lines around Petersburg and were immediately conducted to my headquarters at City Point. They proved to be Alexander H. Stevens, Vice President of the Confederate Confederacy. Judge Campbell, Assistant Secretary of War, and R.M.T. Hunt, formerly United States Senator, and then a member of the Confederate Senate. I at once communicated by telegraph with Washington and informed the Secretary of War and the President of the arrival of these commissioners and that their object was to negotiate terms of peace between the United States and, as they termed it, the Confederate government. I was instructed to retain them at City Point till the President or someone whom he would designate should come to meet them. They remained several days as guests on board the boat. I saw them quite frequently, though I have no recollection of having had any conversation whatever with them on the subject of their mission. It was something I had nothing to do with, and I therefore did not wish to express any views on the subject. For my own part, I never had admitted, and never was ready to admit, that they were representatives of a government. There had been too great a waste of blood and treasure to concede anything of the kind. As long as they remained there, however, our relations were pleasant, and I found them all very agreeable gentlemen. I directed the captain to furnish them with the best boat afforded, and to administer to their comfort in every possible way. No guard was placed over them, and no restriction was put upon their movements, nor was there any pledge asked that they would not abuse the privileges extended to them. They were permitted to leave the boat when they felt like it, and did so, coming up on the bank and visiting me at my headquarters.
Ulysses Grant's memory, the end of the Civil War was near, as he wrote this.
Lee's army was rapidly crumbling. Many of his soldiers had enlisted from that part of the state where we now were, and were continually dropping out of the ranks and going to their homes. Although Sheridan had been marching all day, his troops moved with alacrity and without any straggling. They began to see the end of what they had been fighting 4 years for. Nothing seemed to fatigue them. They were ready to move without rations and travel without rest until the end. Straggling had entirely ceased, and every man was now a rival for the front. The infantry marched about as rapidly as the cavalry could. Sheridan sent Custer with his division to move south of Appomattox Station. So far, only four cavalry and the advance of Lee's army were engaged. Soon, however, Lee's men were brought up from the rear, no doubt expecting that they had nothing to meet but our cavalry. But our infantry had pushed forward so rapidly that by the time the enemy got up, they found Griffin's corps and the Army of the James confronting them. A sharp engagement ensued, but Lee quickly set up a white flag. Thank you.
At the beginning of July 1885, the general was removed to upstate New York to live out his days. As he wrote,
"The arts of peace were carried on in the North. Towns and cities grew during the war. Inventions were made in all kinds of machinery to increase the products of a day's labor in the shop and in the field. In the South, no opposition was allowed to the government which had been set up and which would have become real and respected if the rebellion had been successful. In the North, the country, the towns, and the cities presented about the same appearance they do in time of peace. The furnace was in blast, shops were filled with workmen, the fields were cultivated not only to supply the population of the North and the troops invading the South, but to ship abroad to pay a part of the expense of war. In the North, the press was free up to the point of open treason. The citizens could entertain his views and express them. As I have said, the whole South was a military camp. Colored people, 4 million in number, were submissive and worked in the field and took care of families, while the able-bodied white men were at the front fighting for a cause destined to defeat. The cause was popular and was enthusiastically supported by the young men. The conscription took all of them. Before the war was over, further conscriptions took those between 14 and 18 years of age as junior reserves, and those between 45 and 60 as senior reserves. It would have been an offense directly after the war, and perhaps it would be now, to ask any able-bodied man in the South who was between the ages of 14 and 60 at the time of the war, whether he had been in the Confederate Army. He would assert that he had, or account for his absence from the ranks. Under such circumstances, it is hard to conceive how the North showed such a superiority of force in every battle fought."
As our 18th president lay dying at Mount McGregor, here is what the president wrote.
"Man proposes and God disposes. There are but a few important events in the affairs of men brought about by their own choice. Although frequently urged by friends to write my memoirs, I had determined never to do so, nor to write anything for publication. At the age of nearly 62, I received an injury from a fall, which confined me closely to the house, while it did not apparently affect my general health. This made study a pleasant pastime. Shortly after, the rascality of a business partner developed itself by the announcement of a failure. This was followed soon after by a universal depression of all securities, which seemed to threaten the extinction of a good part of the income still retained, and for which I am indebted to the kindly act of friends. The first volume, as well as a portion of the second, was written before I had reason to suppose I was in critical condition of health. Later, I was reduced almost to the point of death, and it became impossible for me to attend anything for weeks. I have, however, somewhat regained my strength and am able, often, to devote as many hours a day as a person should devote to such work. I would have more hope of satisfying the expectation of the public if I could have allowed myself more time. I've used my best efforts with the aid of my eldest son, F.D. Grant, assisted by his brothers, to verify the records of every statement of fact given. The comments are my own, show how I saw the matters treated of, whether others saw them in the same light or not. With these remarks, I present these volumes to the public, asking no favor, but hoping it will meet the approval of the reader.